Heavenly Father, Lord, we stand in your amazing grace, Lord, and we ask you to just fill us with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Let a fire in our hearts fill us with whatever it is you'd like us to do, Lord. Send us to your work. Help us to bring people close to you. It's in Christ's name we pray.
This like every week, but would you like to ride to church with me? Oh, come on, Mrs. Edwards, you like my church. We have some hot music. It may not be what you're bumping, at all. But it's hot. We get down. What do you say, Mrs. Edwards?
Oh, I suppose.
I've heard it said that 80% of first-time church visitors come because someone personally invited them. All people need to feel loved and wanted, and for some people, it just takes having someone offer to give them a ride to church. We have something great going on at this church. People's lives are being transformed by God's love. Your homework this week is to find at least one person who could use a little more of that love and invite them to come with you next week. Trust me, it's worth the extra effort.
Mrs. Edwards, you want to listen to some music on the way? Go ahead, your choice. Okay, here we are.
All the kids are ready for children's church. Meet Miss Tricia in the back and enjoy children's church. That's just one of the best videos, isn't it? It really is. It's so funny. It's so great. But it's also a great reminder, even though it's summertime, everybody's on vacation. Hey, we're in a new location, and there's lots of people. Everybody's moving. I bet somebody in your neighborhood is buying or selling a house, and there may be a new neighbor, and you can get to know them and tell them what you do on Sunday mornings. It's a great reminder. There's a lot going on in the Northland, and so make sure that you reach out, as the video said. Get to meet one of your neighbors and tell them how great it is being here on a Sunday morning. This is the time of the service when our regular attenders and members, we give offering and we give back to God. If you are a guest or a recent visitor, there's absolutely no expectation that you participate. But for the regular attenders and members, this is what we do. Just a couple of other friendly reminders. At the bottom of your bulletin, you'll actually see a text to give number. So, you know, we try to make it just as easy as we can. So if you forgot your wallet or, you know, you're one of these new millennials with the digital age and you can just text to give. And we can text to give. We also have, you can do ACH automatic with vacations. If you want to make sure that you give to the church, whether you're here or not, you can sign up for electronic giving. And, of course, we are always happy to just anything that you decide that you want to give on a regular basis. It's great. We have a lot of great ministries going on, and that's all because of the generous members that we have here. So at this time, we're getting ready for offering. If everybody will join me in a quick prayer to God. Holy God, thank you so much for all of our great blessings. We have more than most in the world, and we're just here to give back to you a portion of the great blessings that you give to us. Lord God, let every one of these dollars that we give reach more people in our community and reach more people throughout the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
I told you my story. one for me. If I told you my story, you would in life overcome the grave. If I would speak, then let it be all the grace that is greater than all my sin, all the justice must serve, and when mercy wins, all the kindness of Jesus draws me in. All the tale of my story is to tell of Him. This is my story. This is my song. He's in my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. He's in my Savior all the day long. For the grace that's greater than all my sin, of when justice was served and when mercy wins, all the kindness of Jesus draws me in. Oh, to tell my story is to tell of grace that is greater than all my sin. Oh, the justice was served, and when mercy wins, all the kindness of Jesus draws.
You know, we hear the idea of story all the time. It's everywhere around us. All of us, I mean, we've all experienced stories. We love stories. So we are all connected in stories somehow. I get to hear so many stories, and there's some incredible stories. The thing that people love to say when we first sit down, almost every single time, is, I don't really have a great story. Everybody says that. If the living God has taken the time to speak to you, or has shaped you, or has helped you understand something, or grow, or whatever, that's a really big freaking deal. That's not a small story. Regardless of what you think, there is like this holy ground of where God has intersected and spoken specifically to people in your ministries, to you, to what it looks like to be better fathers, or to be better friends, or to love God's word, or to whatever it could be. We're not telling fictional stories. We're telling stories that we believe that there is a God that loves us, that has died for us, paid the ultimate price for us to be in relationship with Him. And so for us, as we tell stories, ultimately at Mariners, our stories always go back to that end. How do we tell stories that affect change in people's lives? Let's always remember that what we are in the business of is moving people from where they're at closer to God, giving God the glory, articulating how God is moving, because, I mean, that's why we're here.
So welcome again to North Star Church. And as you heard in that video, telling your story is why we're here. We all have a story. And this morning, we're going to hear from Roger Nunn. He usually sits back here in the back with his family. He talks with a bit of an accent. And he's going to come up this morning and share his story with us.
Good morning. Al has taken me way out of my comfort zone today. So, as she said of your 10-second service, I'm married to Linda. She is the most beautiful, wonderful woman and my best friend. She is without doubt the love of my life. We have two children, and my stepchildren, but I couldn't love them anymore if they were my biological children. One is 28, the other one is 24. Zach, the one that attends church with us here, is autistic and has OCD. One of the reasons we love North Star is because the congregation has accepted him with his shortcomings. And he loves coming to church. He may not act like it sometimes, but he does. A little bit about me. I'm retired from the construction industry. Most of that time was spent as a field supervisor for a large construction company here in Kansas City. My hobbies are golf, fishing, camping, more camping, and camping every chance I get. When my wife and I got married, I asked her, I said, you like camping? She said, well, I camped as a young girl. It's okay. I took that as meant I love it. So, camping and mine was totally different. Mine was a tent and a sleeping bag down on a lake or river with a fishing pole. Hers was a Holiday Inn with a lakefront or ocean view. We have since compromised. We have a 30-foot travel trailer, and she has learned to deal with that. But really, they wanted me to talk this morning on how my faith has evolved over the years. A little bit, I was raised in a Southern Baptist church in a rural farming community in Kentucky. It was one of those hellfire and brimstone churches. Pastor Tony and I have talked about it, and I told him, I'm not so sure that they instill Christianity in your soul as much as they scared the hell out of it. And I've always wondered about that. We attended church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and every night if there was a revival. And I made up my mind when I left home, I was never getting up early again on Sunday morning. And thank goodness that changed. Start my story. I'd been married previously, and my wife and I had lived down between the lake. For several years, we had a good marriage. Then things started to change. We attended church, and she decided one day she just didn't like church. So we quit attending. And truthfully, that was fine with me because I might have been a good husband, I was a lousy Christian. My faith was very shallow. I went to church because I thought that's what I should do. As time went on, about every 2 or 3 months, she would tell me, I want a divorce. And I'd say, why? I don't know. I'm just not happy. Is it something I've done? Is it something I could do different? No. I stayed on an emotional roller coaster for 2 years. I belonged to Masonic Lodge, and I was on the board of directors there in Clinton, and I went to a meeting one day. And the meeting lasted about an hour and a half, and I come home, and I found her dead. She had committed suicide. No note, no warning, no previous attempts, no nothing. It's hard not to blame yourself for it. You should have been able to recognize it. You should have been able to do something to stop it. I didn't. So my life took kind of a spiral. I was very bitter with God. I was very bitter with life in general. I started drinking. I was lucky for my drinking because I belonged to a Viking club. They were open 7 days a week. I could go at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and start drinking. I didn't have to come home until 2 in the morning. And that's the way I slept. I did that for several months. Luckily, I had some good friends. They got me out of that house, moved me about 20 miles away from my favorite bar, and worked with me, and I quit drinking. And things were going very good. I was bitter with God. He wasn't giving me any answers. I'd ask him, why? Why would you let something like this happen? And I wasn't getting any answers. But the biggest reason I wasn't getting any answers, I wasn't asking the right questions. And I wasn't listening. I'm not even sure I was really asking. I just assumed it just happened. So to make a long story short, I did quit drinking. I will now have a sociable drink, but as far as going to a bar or spending much time in a bar, I just don't do it. A friend comes over, we'll have a drink, that's it. But one of my very, very good friends come to me one day and he said, would you like to meet a nice woman? I said, I don't even want to meet a mean woman. No, I have no interest in meeting a woman. But I was basically lying to myself again because I was tired of hanging out with my buddies. I was tired of being the third wheel at functions. So after I got to thinking about it, he told me the lady's name, and I hadn't met her at a charity function a couple years before, and she did appear to be nice. We started talking. I told him I don't really want to go out on a date, I'd maybe go to a movie or something like that and go home. If she'd like to meet me somewhere, we could have dinner. But just to say I was dating, no, I wasn't interested in that. Very nice lady. We met, and she lived in Kansas City. I lived in Blairstown. So we spent a lot of time talking on the phone. And if you know me very well, you know I don't spend much time on the phone. I can tell you everything I know in 2 minutes on the phone. But we would spend hours talking at night. And it was like we had known each other all of our lives. Well, I ended up marrying her. Best thing I ever did. She got me going to North Star, and she got me involved in a, I'm not sure what you call it. They say don't call it a retreat or a camp, but it's called Casilla. And I would like to stop at this moment and say a prayer. And it's a prayer that I have grown very fond of. And if you will just bow your head for a moment. It's, come, Holy Spirit, and fill the hearts of your faithful, and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit did instruct the hearts of the faithful, grant by the same Spirit we may be truly wise and ever enjoy his consolations. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. I attended, and let me point out, Cresillo, and some of you don't know nothing about it, Cresillo is Spanish for short journey, and it's basically a short journey in Christianity. It doesn't take place of your church, it doesn't take place of your pastor, or your church family. It's just something you attend to kind of revitalize your Christian spirit. It starts on a Thursday night and goes through Sunday. And some people don't get nothing out of it. Some people enjoy it. Some people, it's a life-altering experience. For me, it was a life-altering experience. Best thing that ever happened. And I went ahead and continued to work. I attended as a candidate, got through that. And my wife did tell me, because I didn't actually want to go. I was still not the happiest Christian in the world or the happiest person in the world. But she wanted me to go, and I wanted to make her happy. She did tell me on the way, because she knows me, she said, and I won't use the terminology she used, but she said, if they call me and I have to come and get you, she said, I'm going to be mad. And I said, okie dokie. But I knew I had enough money to get a cab and get home if I needed to. But anyway, I went and attended, and like I said, it was a life-altering. I came out of it renewed. I really did. Everything wasn't cured in me. I wasn't going to be the perfect person, but it really kind of set me on fire. So I went ahead and I kept working. I'd work them. Well, they have them twice a year. And I, some form or fashion, I would do something at one of them. Then they called me and asked me to be the weekend rector for one of them. And I thought, oh, man, I'm not good enough Christian to do this. This is something that's going to take, oh, no. I prayed about it, prayed about it, prayed about it. I told them I'd do it. So I did. There was a lady there that I got to talking to. And her daughter, when she was 11 or 12 years old, had been killed one 4th of July. The next door neighbor was firing guns in the air, and it come down and hit her in the head, killed her. And I listened to her story and how she had grieved. And she said, I'm not over it, but she said, I've learned to deal with it. I had never learned to deal with my wife committing suicide. I had never grieved. I had never shed a tear. I was never a very emotional person. I didn't cry when my mom and dad died. I didn't cry when my younger sister died. I just didn't experience emotion like that. You know, I sat in and listened to her, and I got to thinking about it, and I kept thinking about my former wife. And I could still picture her sitting in that chair when I walked in that house. And that stayed in my mind that whole day. That night I got ready to go to bed, I couldn't sleep. I would start to lay down and go to sleep, and I still have that picture in my mind. So I went to the chapel. It was late. I should have been asleep. And as luck would have it, a minister friend of mine that I would met when I first went to Crescillo with the candidate was in there, and we got to talking. And we talked for about an hour. And he said the same thing. He said, you've never ever got over it. He said, you've never come to grips with it. And we talked for a while, and he left. And he asked, he said, I'll stay if you want me to. And I said, I don't need for you to. I need to be alone. And I sat there, and I cried, and I sobbed for an hour and a half. When I got ready to go back to my room, my T-shirt was soaking wet. But I felt better. I had been bitter with God because I thought he'd done me wrong. What I never realized was how good God had been to me. When I was 2 years old, I had polio. I'm not crippled. Wonder who caused that. Back then, you either was on crutches or you wore leg braces. When I was 11 years old, I spent a year in a tuberculosis sanatorium. They said I had tuberculosis. Come to find out, I didn't. But I spent 9 months, almost a year, around 300 people that did have it. Doctor said, I don't have any effect from it. I wonder who caused that. When I was 13 years old, I had spinal meningitis. They got me to the hospital. The doctor said, if you'd been an hour later, I'd been dead. Thank goodness for my parents' timing. But I wonder who was in control of that. Linda had breast cancer. She's now 3 years cancer-free. I wonder who handled that. I have been so blessed and had so much grace showered on me that I have learned to feel extremely lucky and get over what has happened. There's nothing I could have done about it. I didn't cause it. So now, all I do is pray come to church and try to be a better person each day than I was yesterday. And I'll try to be a better person tomorrow than what I was today. God bless you.